American presidential elections are always over-the-top affairs. Hell, it's the American way. And 2008 is also history in the making. You got your economy in free fall, two raging wars that are not raging so well, and a sitting president with a lower approval rating than herpes. Now you throw in race, religion, and resentment, and my friends, you've got yourself a political tsunami of biblical proportions.
I'll betcha you're gonna hear some fear.
But it comes with a cast of characters straight out of a made-for-TV movie. You've got your feisty hockey mom, the gaffe-happy senator, the straight-talking maverick.
I am not President Bush. If you wanted to run against President Bush, you should have run 4 years ago.
And the man who might be the first black president.
Tonight we mark the end of one historic journey with the beginning of another.
Oh, and that ain't all. Remember Joe the Plumber, don't you?
Joe the Plumber.
Joe the Plumber.
Joe the Plumber.
Joe the Plumber.
Well, now meet Matt the Reporter. You see, Matt Taibbi writes about politics for Rolling Stone, and he's been a regular contributor to Real Time with Bill Maher. This guy has lived undercover as a born-again Christian in Texas, matched wits with 9/11 conspiracy theorists, covered the war in Iraq, and exposed the mind-boggling inner workings of the U.S. Senate. He's also been on the campaign trail since day one, at the primaries, debates, conventions, stump speeches. Now, the big vote takes place tomorrow, and as McCain and Obama, Mick Obama, hit the finish line, Matt is here with the inside story. Everybody say hello to Matt Taibbi.
Good to see you, man. Welcome to the show. How are things?
Good.
Yeah. What up? I mean, you've been covering this campaign from the start, so before we get there, I just need to...
10,000 years already.
It feels that long, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Any interviews on this campaign done while on acid wearing a Viking helmet? Because you
no,
did that in
2004. No, that was actually 2004. No, this time I went without the Viking suit. But I used to do that. I used to carry a Viking suit around with me at all times just in case it was needed.
Just drop a tab, put on a hat, and do an interview?
Yeah, it was funny. Kerry had one of his aides. We used to be work for the ONDCP, which is the Office of National Drug Control Policy. Mm-hmm. And so I used to deal with this guy every day, and one day I thought it would be really funny to drop acid and interview this guy in a Viking suit. So,
Did they catch on?
No, he didn't. He just was looking at me the whole time. Did you write the fried egg ad? And he's like, yeah, it was me.
So in this election, should the question be not who will win, but how much Obama will win by?
Well, we all have to be careful about making predictions. I mean, I remember I was interviewed, the last time I made a prediction was before New Hampshire, and somebody asked me who I thought was gonna win, and I said, Hillary Clinton is done, you know, you can stick a fork in her, it's over, you know, and the next thing you know, she's winning the election. And you know, American elections are very unpredictable. All kinds of things can happen. Every indication is that he's gonna win this thing. John McCain has a very difficult road to victory, especially when you look at the electoral map, but it can still happen, you know.
Can he win the electoral? I mean, John McCain could conceivably win the popular vote and not be president. That's happened before.
Right.
Is that the kind of thing that could happen now?
It could. More likely, though, is that he would. I mean, if his path to victory is probably the Electoral College first of all, I would imagine that he has a better shot at winning that than he does the popular vote.
Yeah. They expect massive turnout. Do you expect that to be to hold true?
Yes, although, you know, traditionally the Republicans have always done better with last-minute turnout. I mean, if you asked Republicans before this election, they always thought that if they were within 3 or 4 points of victory, they were always guaranteeing victory because they had such incredible confidence in their ability to turn out the vote at the last minute. They're on-the-ground machinery. This time around, though, it's supposed to favor Obama. There's so many volunteers out there that I think that he's going to do better in that sense.
Has this been one of the worst-run campaigns you've ever seen by John McCain? The Republicans look like they just blew
like
this.
They're making it up as they went along. It's the weirdest thing. And funny that the press has remarked on this the entire way through. It's like they were completely disorganized. There are all kinds of crazy stories going around. But I heard from one reporter who. Was telling me that the relationship between the media and the McCain campaign got so bad at one point that they came back to the plane one day, and normally they leave little box lunches for the reporters. Everybody went back to their seat and opened the boxes, and they were all empty because they were trying to send a message to the reporters.
Ooh,
this is the kind of thing.
Received loud and clear.
Right, yeah.
But, I mean, you've talked about this in your articles, you know, that this had been a bad campaign by the McCain camp, but also the fact that Obama's kind of lucky and was the right man in the moment.
Yeah, I think, you know, if he had come 4 years earlier or 4 years later, he might have been, you know, the Geraldine Ferraro kind of figure. But he, you know, greatness is one of those things that just happens at, you know, at the right time and the right place. He was lucky to be at this moment in history when, you know, the President Bush's approval rating was so low. He was frankly lucky that the financial crisis happened when it did, and he was lucky that you know, the Iraq War went so badly. I mean, obviously there wasn't a whole lot of good luck that, you know, involved in that whole thing, but you know, all of these things combined to make this sort of a unique once-in-a-generation phenomenon.
You know, the Republicans have run those campaigns, the ads, and also the automated phone calls, the robocalls, trying to scare people, you know, about all the things that Obama will do wrong. And most of it's just kind of like political sort of bullshit that you put that aside. But as an American voter, Obama is not the Lord. So what are the actual real fears that, that the American public has to realize if Obama becomes the president?
What should they really be afraid of?
Yeah, like I'm sure he's not going to just walk in on water. He's inheriting quite a mess, but I'm sure he's not the perfect man. So what are the challenges with a guy like him?
Well, I think the biggest challenge that Barack Obama faces as a politician is that he has to decide what kind of politician he's going to be. He's taken more money from Wall Street than any two other candidates in history, and we have a situation where the next president really has to be, you know, create some very stringent regulations for Wall Street. Now, how do you solve that problem? All the people who got you here are the people who, you know, who yeah. footed your bill, and now you have to turn around and make rules to govern those people. And that's going to be an immediate test that he's going to have to face. And you know, it's really up in the air whether he's going to pass that test or not.
You were there. Maybe one of the funniest political articles I've read in a long time was you talking. You were there when Sarah Palin took the stage for the first time. What was that like?
It was unbelievable. I mean, this entire campaign has been unbelievable just watching some of these people at these speeches. I was at one Palin event, and I was talking to somebody, you know, afterwards, and I was asking, what is it that you don't like about Barack Obama? And this one guy said, you know, in this country, you either are or you aren't, and he aren't. You know, it's just a typical American thing. He aren't. You
he
know?
Aren't.
Yeah.
He aren't what exactly, sir?
Yeah, exactly.
But Palin, I mean, you have been hard on Palin. And I'm not saying it was undeserved, but you have basically said this is exactly what's wrong with the country.
Yeah, you know, Americans, they respond to political advertising sort of the way that they watch television. You know, if they watch a show like Roseanne and it has a character in the show that reminds them of themselves, well, then they're going to buy the Doritos that are advertised in between the segments.
She's just like me.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the, you know, I was at the convention and this one woman was saying, you know, Sarah Palin reminds me of my cousin, you know. And if anybody reminds me of any of my family members, I'm not voting for that person, you know. But, you know, Americans, you know, they look at this, they see somebody who reminds them of themselves or somebody who they know, and that's all the reason they really need to make a decision. And, you know, it's just, it's incredibly irresponsible when you think about it. But
is Palin going to be the first name on the ticket for 2012?
I think absolutely. You know, four years ago, I predicted that Barack Obama was going to be on the ticket this year, and I think this time around, you know, a lot of Democrats are laughing at Sarah Palin right now, and they're blaming her for the destruction of McCain's campaign. But I think she has a big future in the Republican Party, and I think the Republicans see her as the future of the party. They're going to set her up as the.
I think the Republicans did this on purpose. I think they forced McCain to take her, knowing that she would dismantle this campaign.
That's possible.
Because
I mean,
they're smart, man. They know what they're doing. Al Gore won an election and then didn't.
Right.
So you got to think that this is one of those moments going, okay, Mr. McCain, here's what we're going to do.
Yeah, well, I mean, everybody says that that's sort of what happened around convention time. The rumor was that McCain wanted to go with Joe Lieberman as his running mate, and the story is that you know, somebody like Karl Rove must have sat him down and said, dude, you're not going to win, you know, so we're going to make you go in a different direction, and it's going to set us up better for 4 years from now. And it's kind of like the Barry Goldwater situation in 1964. The Republicans took a huge defeat in that election, but it really set, you know, the future of the conservative party up for generations afterwards. And I think, you know, people see Sarah Palin as kind of a, you know, she's a woman. She represents an entirely new demographic strategy for the Republican Party. And I think, you know, that's the direction they're going to go in.
You know, you brought something up interesting. One of your pieces that Sarah Palin took the stage with a teenage daughter pregnant, and had the black candidate done that.
Right.
It would have been spun so much differently.
Especially
by the
if the boyfriend was there with his hat all turned
sideways
and everything like that. You can imagine what America would have done with that scene if it had been on the other way around. But, you know, they welcomed her with open arms. And I think a lot of people, you know, it's funny. It actually, I think that whole situation actually helped them in a weird kind of way. You know, it reminded them that, you know, that this is a candidate who is a lot like people they know, you know, and that helped them out a lot.
What do you think of Joe Biden?
You know, I didn't have a very high opinion of Joe Biden before this. He was a Democrat who supported the war, and he, to me, represented, you know, Barack Obama also could have gone in one of two different directions. He could have gone more towards courting the base of his party, the more liberal wing, or he could have done what Democrats traditionally do in election season, which is act more like Republicans and more conservative. And I think that was the decision he made with Biden. I think they were afraid that he was going to be criticized for a lack of experience.
Didn't you write a book, an article called Eat Me, Joe Biden?
Yeah, I was trying not to bring that up.
You were like back in 2006, you wrote Eat Me, Joe Biden.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Why did you write that? Do you think he is pretending he is who he says he is now?
Well, you know, I think they're probably just telling him, don't say anything. You know, I think that's what they're probably trying to say with him. You know, he has an incredible history of saying really dumb things when there's more cameras rolling, you know, but he's done a fairly good job this time, except for that time he tried to get the guy in the wheelchair to stand up, if you all remember that. That was really funny.
Bad news.
But,
you see all his aides around him going, oh, for the love of God, Joe. You know, as a guy, I mean, I've been reading your stuff, and as a guy who's been covering this from the very beginning, what's the campaign been like to be there every day, and especially in the United States, where you guys do a really good job of heightening the hysteria around everything? And I think the media has done a relatively terrible job in this campaign.
Oh, yeah.
But what's it like being there every day?
Yeah, I mean, if I hear the word change one more time, I'm going to jam an ice pick in my ear, honestly. I mean, it's incredibly boring to watch the campaign just as an ordinary person, you know, on television. But if you have to hear these same speeches, you know, over and over and over again, and the candidates never say anything at all, you know. So I would say on a boringness scale of 1 to 100, it's like a 112 easy.
Wow.
1 to 120, yeah.
Tomorrow, though, how will you be watching? Will you and a bunch of other reporters get around and will the booze start flowing?
The Rolling Stone decided they wanted to go for the maximum gloating effect, so they're sending me out to McCain's victory party in Phoenix to watch that happen. But
you're going to get into a fight.
Yeah, exactly. But the funny thing is McCain's having a kind of unusual party where he's actually not going to appear in person in front of everybody, which is kind of unprecedented, and I think tells you a lot about what they think their chances are. So it's just going to be a bunch of people watching a closed circuit event in a hotel somewhere, which is really depressing.
What is it about the setup where, aside from moments from David Letterman, and those are just moments, aside from it's Rolling Stone magazine that consistently does this kind of political coverage?
Well, I think there's you know, there's an enormous amount of pressure on journalists to create this kind of almost like an atmosphere like sports coverage around political journalism. You know, who's going to win? Who's up in the polls right now? You know, and they use a lot of graphics. In fact, if it's funny, if you watch ESPN's Sunday NFL Countdown and then you watch like a primary night on CNN, it's exactly the same setup. You know, you have your four experts on this side and then the anchorman on that side. And so, you know, there's a lot of pressure on journalists to kind of play up idiotic, stupid, childish themes. And the only people who are really free to kind of take a step back and look at it from, you know, a broader perspective are magazines or people who don't have to file every 10 seconds the way most reporters do. So I don't think it's anything specific to us. I just think it's our, you know, our time schedule that is unique.
It's Matt Taibbi. He's got a book called The Great Derangement. It's in stores now. Thanks for coming in, man.
Thank you so much.
Everyone. All right, Farley Moat is coming up next. Plus, we throw our own few darts and laurels at Obama and McCain. Thanks, Bob.